Harper Audio presents Brief Encounters with Che Guevara. Stories by Ben Fountain. Performed by Christian Baskous. Near Extinct Birds of the Central Cordillera. I extended to the commandant the opportunity to walk the floor of the exchange with me, and he seemed reasonably intrigued. Richard Grasso, Chairman, New York Stock Exchange, Bogota, Colombia, June 26, 1999. No way, Blair insisted to anyone who asked. No self-respecting bunch of extortionist rebels would ever want to kidnap him. He was the poorest of the poor, poorer even than the hard-scrabble campesinos pounding the mountains into dead slag heaps. John Blair, graduate assistant slave and aspiring Ph.D., whose idea of big money was a $20 bill. In case of trouble, he had letters of introduction from Duke University, the von Humboldt Institute, and the Instituto Geográfico in Bogotá, whose director was known to have contacts in the Movimiento Unido de Revolucionarios de Colombia, the MURC, which controlled unconscionable swaths of the southwest Cordilleras. For 3 weeks, Blair would hike through the remnant cloud forest, then go back to Duke and scratch together enough grants to spend the following year in the Huila district, where he would study the effects of habitat fragmentation on rare local species of parrotlets. It could be done, it would be done, it had to be done. Even before he'd first published in a peer-reviewed journal at age 17 in Auk, field notes on the breeding and diet of the Tovey parakeet, Blair had known his was likely the last generation that would witness scores of these species in the wild, which fueled a core urgency in his boyhood passion, obsession, his bewildered parents would have said, for anything avian. Full speed ahead and damn the politics. As it happened, they grabbed him near Popayan, a brutally efficient bunch in jungle fatigues who rousted all the livestock and people off the bus. Blair hunched over, trying to blend in with the compact Indians, but a tall, skinny gringo with a big backpack, might as well have had a turban on his head. "You," said the comandante in a cool voice, "you're coming with us." Blair started to explain that he was a scholar, thus worthless in any monetary sense. He'd been counting on his formidable language skills to walk him through this very sort of situation. But one of the rebels was into his backpack now, spilling the notebooks and Zeiss Jena binoculars into the road, then the Leica with a Cannon Barrel 200X zoom, Blair's most valuable possessions, worth more than his car. "He's a spy," announced the rebel. "No, no," Blair politely corrected. "Soy ornitólogo, estudiante."
"You're a spy,"
declared the comandante, poking Blair's notebooks with the tip of his gun. "In the name of the Secretariat, I am arresting you." When Blair protested, they hit him fairly hard in the stomach, and that was the moment he knew that his life had changed. They called him La Merca, the merchandise, and for the next 4 days he slogged through the mountains eating cold arepas and sardines and taking endless taunts about firing squads, although he did, thanks to an 80-mile-a-week running habit, hold up better than the oil executives and mining engineers the rebels were used to bringing in. The first day, he simply put down his head and marched, enduring the hardship only because he had to. But as the column moved deeper into the mountains, a sense of possibility began to assert itself, a signal too faint to call an idea. To the east, the Cordillera was scorched and spent, rubbled by decades of desperate agriculture. The few mingy scraps of surviving forest were eerily silent, but once they crossed the borders of the MURC-controlled zone, the vegetation closed around them with the density of a cave. At night, Blair registered a deep suck and gurgle, the engine of the forest's vast plumbing system. Mornings they woke to the screams of peahop birds. Then the mixed species flock started in with their contrapuntal yammerings and groks and crees that made the forest sound like a construction site. In 3 days on the trail, Blair reliably saw 14 species on the CITES endangered list, as well as an exceedingly rare haplopsitica perched in a fern the size of a minivan. He was amazed and said as much to the young comandante, who eyed him for a moment in a thoughtful way. "Yes," the rebel answered, "ecology is important to the revolution. As a scholar," he gave a faint, possibly ironic smile, "you can appreciate this." And he made a little speech about the environment, how the Firmeza Revolucionario had banned the multinational logging and mining mafias from all liberated zones. The column reached base camp on the fourth day, trudging into the fortified MURC compound through a soiling rain. They hauled Blair straight to the Office of Complaints and Claims, where he sat for 2 hours in a damp hallway staring at posters of Lenin and Che, wondering if the rebels planned to shoot him today. When at last they led him into the main office, Comandante Alberto's first words were,
"You don't look like a spy."
A number of Blair's possessions lay on the desk. Binoculars, camera, maps, and compass. The notebooks with a microscopic Blairian scribble. Seven or eight subcomandantes were seated along the wall, while Alberto, the comandante máximo, studied Blair with the calm of someone blowing smoke rings. He resembled a late-period Jerry Garcia in fatigues, a heavy man with steel-rimmed glasses, double bags under his eyes, and a dense Brillo bush of graying hair. "I'm not a spy," Blair answered in his wired, earnest way. "I'm an ornithologist. I study birds."
"However," Alberto continued, "if they wanted to send a spy, they wouldn't send somebody who looked like a spy. So the fact that you don't look like a spy makes me think you're a spy."
Blair considered. "And what if I did look like a spy?"
"Then I'd think you're a spy."
The subcomandantes hawed like drunks rolling around in the mud. So was it all a big joke, Blair wanted to know? Or was his life really at stake? Or both? Which meant he would probably go mad. "I'm an ornithologist," he said a little breathlessly. "I don't know how many ways I can tell you that, but it's true. I came to study the birds." Alberto's jaws made a twisted, munching motion, like he was trying to eat his tongue.
"That's for the Secretariat to decide. All cases of spying go to the Secretariat, and even if you are what you say you are, you'll have to stay with us while your release is arranged."
"My release?" Blair echoed bitterly. "You know kidnapping is a crime in most countries, not to mention a violation of human rights."
"This isn't a kidnapping. This is a retention in the socio-political context of the war. We merely hold you until a fee is paid for your release."
"What's the difference?" Blair cried. And when Alberto wouldn't answer, he came slightly unglued. "Listen," he said, "I don't have any money. I'm a student, okay? In fact, I'm worse than worthless. I owe $20,000 in student loans. And if I'm not back at Duke in 2 weeks," he went on, his voice cracking with the wrongness and rage of it all, "they're going to give my teaching assistant slot to somebody else. So would you please just save us all a lot of trouble and let me go?" They scanned his passport photo instead, then posted it on their website with a $5 million ransom demand, which even the hardcore insurgents knew was a stretch.
"Sixth Front gets the Exxon guys," Subcomandante Lauro muttered. "And we get the scientist with the holes in his boots."
He became known around camp as John Blair. Always the two names together, John Blair. But John got mangled in the depths of their throats so that it came out as the even more ridiculous Joan. In any case, they couldn't seem to speak his name without smiling. 30 years of low-intensity warfare had given the rebels a heightened sense of the absurd, and Blair's presence was just too fertile to ignore. A gringo so thick, so monumentally oblivious, that he'd walked into the middle of a war to study a bunch of birds.
"So, tell me, John Blair," one of the subcomandantes might say, pointing to a mannequin spouting trills and rubatos, or the tanagers that streaked around like meteor showers. "What is the name of that species, please?" He knew they were testing him, nominally probing for chinks in his cover, but more than that, they were indulging in the fatuous running joke that seemed to follow him everywhere, which he handled by coming right back at them, rattling off the Latin and English names and, often as not, the Spanish, along with genus and all the natural history he could muster before the rebel waved his arms and retreated. But an implacable sense of mission was rising in Blair. He eyed the cloud forest lapping the compound's walls and knew that something momentous was waiting for him. "If you let me do my work," he told Comandante Alberto, "I'll prove to you I'm not a spy."
"Well," Alberto answered,
"perhaps." A man of impressive silences and ponderous speech, who wore his gravitas like a pair of heavy boots. He had a habit of studying his hands while he spoke, slowly turning them back and forth while he declaimed Marxist rhetoric in the deep, rolling voice of a river flowing past giant boulders.
"First, the Secretariat must review your case."
Always the Secretariat, MURC's great and powerful Oz. In the evenings, the officers gathered on the steps of their quarters to listen to the radio and drink aromatica tea. Blair gradually insinuated himself onto the bottom step. And after a couple of weeks of Radio Nacional newscasts, he understood that Colombia was busily ripping itself to shreds. Gargantuan car bombs rocked the cities each week. Judges and journalists were assassinated in droves. Various gangs, militias, and guerrillas fought the army and the cops, while the drug lords and revanchists sponsored paramilitary autodefensa squads that seemed to specialize in massacring unarmed peasants. In their own area, Blair could hear shooting at night, and the distant thud of helicopters during the day. Rebel patrols brought in bodies and bloody autodefensa prisoners, while U.S. Air Force planes gridded the sky overhead, reconnoitering the local coca crop. "Where," Blair asked during a commercial break, "is this zone of disarmament they're always talking about?"
"You're in it,"
Subcomandante Tono answered, to which Lauro added with a mocking snarl,
"You mean you couldn't tell?"
Some evenings, Alberto joined them. Usually, when one of his interviews was being broadcast, he'd settle onto the steps with a mug of tea and listen to himself lecturing the country on historical inevitability, or the Bolivarian struggle, or the venomous strategies of the World Bank. After one such broadcast, he turned to Blair.
"So, John Blair, what do you think of our position?"
"Well," Blair said in his most formal Spanish, "of course, I support these things as general principles, an end to poverty, an equitable education system, elections where everyone is free to participate." The officers murmured patronizingly and winked at each other. Amid the strenuous effort of articulating himself, Blair barely took notice. "But, frankly, I think you're being far too timid in your approach. If you really want to change society, you're going to have to start thinking in more radical terms." The group endured several moments of intense silence until Alberto cleared his throat.
"For example, John Blair?"
"Well, you're always going on about agrarian reform, but face it, you're just evading the real issue. If you really want to solve the land problem, you're going to have to get away from the cow. They're too big. They overload the whole ecosystem. What we have to do is forget the cow and switch over to a diet of mushrooms and insects."
"Mushrooms and insects?" Lauro cried. "You think I'm risking my ass out here for mushrooms and insects?"
But Alberto was laughing.
Shut up, Lauro. He gave an honest answer. I like this guy. He doesn't bullshit around. With 100 guys like him, I could take Bogota in about 2 weeks.
During the day, Blair was free to wander around the compound. For all their talk of his being a spy, the rebels didn't seem to mind him watching their drills, though at night they put him in.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.